go full blast now. I came to this world to help the world focus on the issue of eternal life. Focus on eternal life. And it hasn't been very successful. The people here, the mindset here doesn't really get it at all. But anyway, it seems too difficult to us. But keep in mind that help arrives at certain times. You get help along the way. So I'd like to believe that these videos are help for those of us who really want to focus in on eternal life. What are we really talking about when we say eternal life? This is a big question, right? And this is what I've always focused on. So we are going to kind of do it's very interesting. You have to be somewhat indirect. Okay, somewhat circumspect, somewhat indirect. We have, for instance, in this day and age, a incredible book called A Course in Miracles, which focuses on eternal life and explains that we are eternal life, and mortal life is nothing but a dream. It's nothing really but a dream. It's a pretension, as I put it. It's a pretension. We're pretending. And it's purported to be by Jesus. And Jesus is not happy at all with the religions that have sprung up around his name. Not at all. and I thinking, oh my gosh, what, you know, why? Well, I've done a very strong, in-depth look at all of this. And it's quite surprising. It's quite surprising. And I'm getting a sense of what it's all about, a general sense. It's important to get this overall feel for something. Don't get stuck in details. Get a feel for it. And let that feel sink in where you feel comfortable with the overall perspective. You know, the overall perspective is what you want. You don't want to get lost in the trees, you know, and don't lose sight of the forest because you're focused on too much on the trees. So you need to be like a generalist when you're going to understand eternal life. You need to be very much of a generalist. Don't get hung up on labels, details, facts, dates, things like that. Just take it in, process it, and say, okay, what's the overall picture here? What's the overall picture? Now, the issue is, of course, that we have this great advocate for eternal life right now, and we're told that we can accept eternal life. We can stop pretending to be dead, spiritually dead. And we have practices that will allow this to happen now, four-stage practice especially, where you imitate abstraction, imitating abstraction. And we're saying, okay, but how do we then account for Christianity, for instance, for example, the past, the history of this planet? And this seems to be like a problem for us. So I'm tackling this a little bit by bit by bit by bit. I'm getting a feel for the whole situation. And it's very different than what we would expect. The Pope is coming to the United States of America. September, what, 22nd, 23rd, 24th, some, like a very important trip. And Joe Biden, the Vice President, is really excited. He's a Catholic. And the mortician in chief is very happy about it and saying, I love this Pope, you know. He has, we have common ideals. We really think alike. And I'm saying, uh-oh, really? The MOTUS, the mortician in chief, mortician of the United States, the chief mortician, it thinks, and the Pope think alike. I said, that doesn't really exactly reassure me. And then Joe Biden says, you know, this Pope really gets it. He's finally brought the church back to what its main, its true mission is, which is what? Social work, he says. Social work. I'm not sure Jesus was too thrilled about that. I think Jesus told me, hey, look into this. Keep looking into this here. Come on, let's clear this up here. Really? The chief mission of the Catholic Church is social work? Wow. I thought it was eternal life. I thought Jesus' mission here was to tell us that we are eternal life. He said, I came to bring you eternal life, the bread of eternal life, the teachings that will awaken you to eternal life. Jesus is all about eternal life. That is it. That is it. So you talk about things being upside down right now in the world. We are lost sheep here, folks. We are lost sheep. And here's a voice in the wilderness crying out, you know, hey, eternal life is where it's at. Focusing on eternal life is where it's at. And do not be overly intimidated by it, because you will find help as you go along. And it becomes easier, and you'll be able to go quicker. And you say, wow, maybe I can clear this up. So keep working at it here. Keep working at clarification. There's this idea that Christians have, that Christianity just suddenly popped up like this when Jesus came here, and like a mushroom, boom, you know, really quickly popped up in some sort of primitive land that, you know, before that it was all primitive and nobody knew what they're talking about. And then boom, Christianity, here's the answer. And it's a radically new, everything's different, completely new. And, you know, this is it. So I was astonished as I started digging through this. I mean, I've looked at it throughout my life, but never, you know, have we had we have access to all sorts of scholarly opinions now, for instance, on Wikipedia, which it's a help. It's a help. It really is. You know, critical opinions, looking at it from different perspectives, etc. But you, so you have to be piece it together, you know, kind of like, all the reviews on eBay or Yelp or something. I mean, you know, you got to say, well, who's just a shill for the company? Who's just a sour grape who has a personal axe to grind, trying to tear him down? You know, who are these posters are saying, you know, yes, yay and nay? And, you know, draw, you know, your own intuitive, you know, reason-based conclusions. And I know intuition and reason, they're not separate, they're one. It's intellect that is not the same as reason at all. It's not intellect. We can easily get trapped in our intellect. Many people get trapped in their intellect. I've been trapped, everyone's been trapped. Reason is something very different. It sounds the same, sounds very similar. It's very different. Its goal is the realization of eternal life, and that's it. And it's a beautiful generalist, and it's fluid and it's spontaneous and it's able to go with the flow, and it's just marvelous how it's, oh, I see that, and it can talk with intellectuals and it can talk the intellectual game, etc. But it has a different premise, it has a different direction, it has a different purpose. So we're speaking from the standpoint of spiritual intuition, reason. And we go gently, we're sweet about it, we have humor about it. See, reason is that way. It's sweet, it's humorous, lighthearted, even when we're looking at the most intense stuff, stuff that the intellect will just boil over, you know, the intellect just gets all boily, you know. not reason, because reason just touches it lightly. See, let's not get stuck here. Let's not get stuck here. Take a look at it. So, the understanding of most of us about Christianity, it is one thing, and the facts are something else. Okay, we pretty much believe what we want to believe and wish it was this way, and this is what happened. This isn't, you know, but it's not. Now, the issue, did Jesus exist or not? Well, here's the problem with those that say Jesus never existed. I'll tell you this, Jesus certainly exists now. Certainly exists now. A Course in Miracles is very strong evidence of this, and also the inner experiences I've had of associating with Jesus, very strong, and others too. So I would say that to try to make the case that Jesus doesn't exist is, you know, it's not doable really. Now the question is, did Jesus exist back 2,000 years ago? Well, you know, why not? Why not, if Jesus exists now, why not Jesus existed back then too, and got the ball rolling, you know? But in any case, Jesus exists now, okay? So why are we so worried? I mean, I'm not worried about what the past shows me. I have an open mind, so whatever it shows me is what it shows me, and whatever the case turns out to be, that's fine, because I know that Jesus exists now. So why am I worried? If it happened to turn out that Jesus never existed in the past, that wouldn't bother me at all. I'd say, well, yeah, but Jesus exists now, and the teachings he's giving now are stupendously effective. So, you know, where's the concern? It's just like saying this world and these bodies and the universe, you know, has it existed or not? And if it turns out it's never existed, what doesn't bother me. I understand. I would understand why. It's just a pretense. It's a pretense. And reality, my reality still exists entirely of freedom, all power, all glory, all freedom, all spaciousness. Everything is actually just pure spaciousness. So that wouldn't bother me. So you have an open mind, you see. See, whatever the facts are, let come what may. It doesn't change the fact that I am eternal life. Eternal life is the only life there is. Doesn't change it in the slightest bit. So I'm not bothered by it. Now, some people might, it is shocking, of course, when you start going over some of this stuff, you say, uh-oh. Things aren't quite the way that we're told. They were. Not by a long shot. Not by a long shot. Not by a long shot. Let me dig through some pictures here, and just bear with me. And we're going to do a little historical excursion here. And why is this important? It's important so that nothing bothers us, you know, nothing. What's really important is to not allow those who say, well, Jesus doesn't exist at all, and eternal life doesn't exist, it's all nonsense and things like that. It's important to not get rattled by this ideology at all. You just shrug it off. You say, well, you know, I know there's great teachings towards eternal life, and that's all that counts, so I'm not concerned. I'm only concerned about the big picture. I'm only concerned about the big picture. Now, we have, speaking of a picture, here's a nice little picture. And this picture is, well, we'll get back to this one. Here you go. That previous picture was of Pergamon. We'll get back to that. It's intriguing. It probably has got your attention right now. So what is that? Well, let's first talk about John the Baptist. And we're going to go about in a roundabout way, but I think you'd find it pretty interesting. John the Baptist, okay. John the Baptist was a contemporary of Jesus Christ, born about 6 months before he was born. Elizabeth, his mother, was a close relative of mother of Jesus, Mary, which is actually an Egyptian name. M-E-R-I, Mary means beloved. And John the Baptist was an activist. He was he was going about the countryside, preaching, talking, drawing great crowds, and he was creating quite a stir, quite an astonishment in Judea. And his name became very well known. He, you know, kind of burst out of nowhere, and he had this charisma. He had this great charisma, and he told people, "Listen. I'm nothing compared to the one that's to come. Nothing. I'm not even worthy to hold his sandals, wipe the dust off his sandals or something. He's just, he's way, way greater than me." He's talking about Jesus. But keep in mind, when John the Baptist was preaching, Jesus was also living in Galilee, or, you know, he was wherever he was. He was a contemporary. They're both there. Okay. So, Eventually, John baptized Jesus. But before we get to that, I want to throw a curveball at you here, which is something which is quite interesting. I think you might find it disturbing too. But this came to me yesterday in a flash. What if right now there's a John the Baptist figure? Okay, John the Baptist figure. And here we have a painting of John the Baptist, and here we have a superimposition of Mr. Donald J. Trump. What does the J stand for? Okay, and don't go wandering off right now, because we'll loop everything back to the Pergamon, but it's an intriguing story, and this is just a way to, you know, it's an attention getter here. J stands for John. Okay, Donald John Trump. Now, he's going around, he came, you know, burst on the political scene, preaching a very radical doctrine, shocking people, just like John the Baptist did. What John the Baptist said was quite, you know, shocking to people. He was like, people said, "Wow, this guy's a maniac." You know, I mean, what he's saying? Holy cow! But a lot of people said, "Hey, I like this guy. I like his tone. I like his fervor. I like his sincerity. I like this." But what he was saying was quite radical. Okay, quite radical. But he drew large crowds, bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. We have this situation now with Trump, Donald John Trump, who, there's parallels here. There's a lot of parallels, actually. He's very charismatic. He's drawing huge crowds. He's burst on the scene, and the establishment hates him and wants to get rid of him, just like they hated John the Baptist. They hated John the Baptist. And John the Baptist points to something bigger than him. Something else is to come. And it seems like Trump really, does he really want to be president, or is he pointing to something that is coming? Is he preparing us for something to come? John the Baptist prepared people for something that was to come. And of course, he told the people what was to come was Jesus Christ. Okay? That's what John the Baptist was preparing people for, is that he said, pretty soon, there's this one that's to come who's going to be knocking on your door, and I'm not worthy to even hold his sandals. I'm not worthy to even hold his sandals, okay? So, if we're in sync here, I hope we're in sync with these pictures. What is Trump preparing people for? He's preparing people for something. Now, it's different times, but there's parallels. There's the establishment. There's some anti-establishment figure that pops onto the scene and begins discoursing, talking to people, and is very, very, very charismatic and unconventional. And the establishment is just going nuts and, wow, shut up, shut up, shut up, shut up, shut up, shut up, shut up. And so we are asking here, and it popped into my mind. I said, hey, wait a minute. What if Donald Trump, John Trump, is John the Baptist? What if Donald John Trump is John the Baptist, playing a very similar role? Because I have said that Jesus Christ is back in the world. Now, keep in mind that Jesus was there while John was preaching, right? He just hadn't come out yet. And when John baptized Jesus in the River Jordan, that's when his ministry began. He hadn't come out yet, all right? So nobody really knew what was going on. So Jesus, I say, he's already back. He could be here already, but he hasn't really come out yet. He hasn't really come out yet. Those who are close to him should be aware he's here. He already announced it, and those who had the ears to hear it. But he's waiting for something. He's waiting for something. What did John the Baptist do? John the Baptist prepared the world for Jesus Christ. Okay, prepared the world for Jesus Christ. What if Trump is preparing the world for Jesus Christ also in a certain way? Now, how would Trump be doing this? He doesn't seem to be a very religious person, so to speak. But what John the Baptist did was freed people's minds up from the establishment of the time, the law, the religion of Judaism, the way things were. He prepared people and seemed to free him up from that. Okay? Got them ready so that they could hear some really profound gospel, really some profound gospel, which eventually came as Jesus gave out his gospel. Donald John Trump was saying, what if Donald Trump is John the Baptist? What if Donald Trump is John the Baptist? He is very anti-establishment. He's pointing out that the whole political game says, hey, look, I know the political game, the lobbyists, how they work. These candidates are bought and paid for, absolutely bought and paid for, but they can't buy me. I don't need their money. And both Republicans and Democrats are furious with him, and they want him out of the way because he is completely throwing the money changers out of the temple, so to speak, which is what Jesus did, but use that analogy. He's overturning the apple cart, the gravy train. He says, hey, folks, it's corrupt. It's corrupt. Not only is it corrupt, but the media, the corporate-controlled media, is extraordinarily corrupt and should not be listened to. They're lying, distorting, deceiving, and attacking and trying to destroy me by very devious means. I remember the picture that Trump has had on Google for the longest time. You Google Donald Trump, and there's a picture on the right-hand side. They may have changed it at this point, finally. And it's the ugliest picture you can imagine. The media loves to find, go through the video and find, you know, pull a frame out of video that shows Trump looking like some drooling, you know, someone who's mentally or challenged, drooling or something. I mean, just, they want to make him look as terrible as possible, idiotic as possible. You know, this is sabotage. This is wickedness. Okay. He's not that person. They're building up a straw man, a false man. So he's saying the establishment is lying to you. Open, think for yourself. Trust in yourself. Think in yourself. You know, we don't have to be bullied around. He's standing up to the bullies, actually. Very similar to what John the Baptist did. In helping people say, hey, wait a minute, you know, maybe I'm not crazy. Maybe I'm not stupid. Maybe I have some common sense. Maybe I have some intelligence. Maybe I can start breathing and start thinking for myself. Maybe I don't have to believe the narrative that the corporate media is presenting to me, which is really controlled by the massive healthcare complex in the world, which is run by pharmaceutical companies, actually. Which the last thing they want you to do is start thinking about eternal life. That's the very last thing they want you to do. So John the Baptist got people ready for the gospel of eternal life, okay? That is because Jesus brought the gospel of eternal life. That is what Jesus did. So John the Baptist got the people of the country ready for that. Now, maybe Trump is fulfilling a similar purpose. A similar purpose is saying, folks, get off your knees, get on your feet. Stop believing the narrative, the PC narrative, which is really pharmaceutical culture narrative. That's what political correctness is all about. They're saying, everybody, you got to do this. This is the narrative you have to follow. Your mortal mind, period. There's no such thing as eternal mind. You know, and just deal with it. You know, you're going to get sick. You're going to get old. You're going to need all these drugs and healthcare system, etc. And these lobbyists, a lot of them are from the healthcare industry, okay, that he's talking about. A lot of them. So these candidates are bought and paid for. Trump is a wild card. He's not beholden to anyone. Okay, now, John the Baptist may have had some flaws. Okay, Trump may have some personal flaws. Okay, fine. But be that as it may, what's his function? What is he doing? Is he helping is he helping out or not? And I'm saying, you know, hey, he's fulfilling a similar role to John the Baptist. He's preparing us for Jesus. Okay? He's saying, John the Baptist said, repent, 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 repent. Trump is saying, don't listen to the media, don't listen to the media, don't listen to the lies, don't listen to the lies. Turn away from these other candidates who are bought and paid for. Turn away from these other candidates that are bought and paid for. Turn away from, you're sold out. They're going to sell you out. They're going to sell you out. Don't go for that. You can do better. You can do better. You can do better. All right. Well, this is at least clearing the cobwebs out of our minds. You know, at least is clearing the cobwebs out of our minds and being helpful. And ultimately, the gospel of Jesus is that eternal life is what we are. Mortal mind is an illusion. It doesn't really exist. It's a pretense. It's a pretense. It's a pretense. Now, you see all these horrible photographs of Trump. You know, they try to catch him when he's being assertive. You know, standing up and being assertive and make him look like he's a terrible ogre. You know, but it's not that really that way. And people listen to him and say, you know what? All I did was I listened with an open mind when he was talking with the people of the Chicago News or Tribune or whatever for about an hour or something. And I just listened and just opened my. I said, what am I hearing? And I said, hey, you know. Okay, it is what it is. This is what I heard. And as this continues on, I just say, okay, it is what it is. This is what I'm hearing. He's not some hideous, you know, wife-beating ogre that, you know, the media tries to present him in some hideous, distorted way. And it's not there. It's not there. You know, warts and all, there's not some hideous ogre there, really. Okay, is the way they're trying to portray it. And, you know, this character assassination. And the media are assassins, actually. They really are assassins. Okay, so I'm saying Donald Trump is John the Baptist. Donald Trump is our John the Baptist right now. Okay, we have a John the Baptist figure. Repent, repent, repent. Turn away from the lies of mortal mind. Okay, the media, the corporate-controlled media, is feeding you nothing but the lies of mortal mind. Okay. nothing but the lies of mortal mind. That's all they're feeding you. And they want that to prevail. And they want that to be the only system there is. Okay? So, now we get back to the biblical John the Baptist, who said, get ready, repent, 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 repent. Jesus, you know, the Son of God is coming. Someone really important is coming. And it turns out it was Jesus. So, John the Baptist, they call him John the Baptist because he baptized people. He baptized. Now, in Christianity, which is full immersion, they think. Now, Christianity teaches that this was something totally new. And it was, you know, some new religion, some new teaching that, you know, that just was suddenly, you know, burst upon like a new child. Everything's new. Everything's different. Everything's better. It's all in remission of sins. You'd be baptized. You're baptized. Well, if you go back and really look at the whole situation of baptism, you come away with a very different conclusion. Very, very different conclusion. And not many really have dug into this. But I just, you know, just said, let me, I'm curious, the Holy Spirit said, take a look at this. So before, I wonder, was this some Jewish custom? Well, Jews had a custom of ritual purification with water, but it was something that was done if you had become unclean in some way before entering the temple. You need to wash yourself with water, and there's some purification. You know, the idea, baptism is sympathetic magic, because we know that our bodies get dirty. You know, clothes get dirty. What do? We wash them in water. The grime, the grit, the dirt, is water washes it away. So they just use this analogy of sympathetic magic. Well, if it can do that, if we immerse the entire body in water and believe that this is somehow washing the dirt off our heart, our mind, our spirit, you see, cleansing our spirit of water, the way that applying water to our exterior cleanses away the dirt and the grime of dust of the world. It's sympathetic magic, all right, is what it is. It's simply believing, well, it works in this case, so it should work then somehow. We can imagine that it washes away all our sins, too. Okay. A lot of religion is based on sympathetic magic, actually. Very, 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 very prevalent in ancient times, and still in our times, we still go for that. Okay. Now, did John the Baptist invent baptism, immersion baptism? Is that true? Is that really true? It's a question, right? It's a question. All right. So, we will bop up here, and we're going to get a picture, I hope. Oh, okay. This is a recreation. This is going to be a recreation of this city called Pergamon. P-P-R-G-A-M-O-N. They maybe spell it in Greek Roman times with a U-M, but Pergamon. Pergamon. This is called the Acropolis, which is basically a hill, sort of a plateaued hill, like the Acropolis in, I think, what was it? Greece. Greek had an Acropolis, or was it, you know, or Rome, but I think it's Greece, but Rome also had a Acropolis, I believe. I could be wrong about that. Now, the Capitoline Hill, I think it was Athenian Acropolis in Athens, maybe. So there's this complex here. You're looking at a complex here. This is the Acropolis, the buildings on the Acropolis of Pergamon. Okay. This is a recreation, and you're taking a look at this and say, what? You know, what? This looks pretty sophisticated. Yeah, it does, doesn't it? And here is a side view of, and this is like in, you know, B.C. We're talking about B.C. here, possibly, you know, we're talking B.C. We are talking B.C. Let me see. Well, a lot of maybe this isn't BC. Okay, maybe it isn't. But it's ancient. It's ancient. It's maybe the first century or the second century too. This is a side view. Maybe they say Hadrian built some of this or rebuilt a lot of it. But massively incredible buildings, okay? Incredible buildings. This is, you know, if we were plopped down in this today, we would just say, wow. You know, this is, boy, this has some amenities here. This is quite a layout here. And beautiful marble and beautiful columns and roofs and water systems and pools and baths and temples, etc., etc., etc. Very, very sophisticated. Now, one of those structures in Pergamon, one of those structures happened to be what is now called the Red Basilica. The Red Basilica. All right, here it is. Here's a picture. Now, this just gives a small idea of the mammoth size of this structure. And this is a very interesting building, and we will get back to this. I want to... they say this structure was so grand and so huge it dwarfed the Temple of Jupiter at Baalbek. Now, Baalbek's a place in Lebanon, okay. And the Temple of Jupiter is there was this massive... There's a massive temple complex there. And this is just some of what's surviving. But this is the Temple of Baalbek at Jupiter is famous for the massive foundation stones, which they think is ancient, predates the Temple of Jupiter. The Temple of Jupiter was built on these foundation stones. Here's a picture of one of those foundation stones. And here's a person there standing on the, to give you an idea of how big this stone is. This is embedded in the ground right now. It was maybe quarried and wasn't moved. And it goes on from it goes out of this the frame of this picture. It goes on. This is just one solid stone that they used. Somehow they moved this stone into place and set it into found beautifully, immaculately into the foundation of this that the Temple of Jupiter was built upon, perhaps at a later date. At the complex, there's also the Temple of Bacchus in Baalbek. Okay, look at that temple, all right? We're talking about, they built some monumental, incredible temples there. And the greatest temple of all in the ancient world was the Seraphim in Alexandria. Now, what was the Seraphim? Let's talk about that, because this is quite interesting. We get back to this building here, the Red Basilica. We call it the Red Basilica. We call it the Red Basilica because it was a Christian church. But was it originally a Christian church? And the answer is no. Christians took over this church. I'm not sure at which date, but probably after Theodosius, the Emperor Theodosius declared Christianity the religion of the land, or basically shut down the pagan temples, started that process. I think was Justinian actually made it the official religion of the Roman Empire. But originally this was a pagan temple. It was a pagan temple. And it was a very, very impressive pagan temple, to say the least. They dwarfed the Temple of Jupiter at Baalbek, which is this is astonishingly gigantic temple. This dwarfed it. Okay, in Pergamon. Let me see here. All right. What was this temple before? This temple was for Serapis. Serapis. Serapis was this syncretic combination of Egyptian and Greek. It's something that the Ptolemies of Egypt, which were Greek rulers of Egypt, they invented this religion, and it flourished in Egypt, and it kept the Isis Osiris worship, which had been prevalent in Egypt for thousands and thousands of years, but it introduced sort of a Greco figure, we call it a Serapis figure. Let me see if I can pull up something here. It was this god that was worshipped, and there was all these mystery rites surrounding this. One, this is going. I'm going to pull you up a sort of a freeze here. of Serapis. There you go. It's cut out of stone, and it's someone with, you know, long curly hair and a long curly beard, stylized in the Greek, sort of a Greek pagan god style. Okay. The greatest temple of all was in Alexandria, the Seraphim in Alexandria. The writings about it from contemporary witnesses who viewed it said there's absolutely no words that can describe it. Any word you use is going to be faint praise. It's just quite astonishing, this temple. There's another one in Memphis, Egypt. And these Seraphims were spread throughout the Greco-Roman world. They were in many, many, many places. And this religion was extraordinarily popular, especially in the form of Isis worship. Many temples to Isis, too, statues of Isis, throughout the Greco-Roman Empire. And it was there was this very strong religion, starting from about, 200 B.C., at least 200 B.C., lasting for at least 500 years. Extremely popular. It was the most popular religion of that time. And this great red basilica, the red basilica, was a Seraphim. It was a church dedicated to Serapis. Now, what is interesting, what we're getting at here, is that this, we call it a cult, but it was a religion, the religion of Serapis, mystery cult, mystery religion, of these, that have these rites and mysteries. What they used was immersion, baptism by water, washing away of the sins, immersion in water to wash away our sins and be born again as an initiate now of this religion. So, and where did they get that? Well, that had been going on for thousands of years in Egyptian religion. Okay, where the flooding of the Nile was used as a rebirth of the land, and initiates would go through some immersion experience of water to symbolize this rebirth of land. Now, most religions in ancient times are agricultural based. They're agricultural based. And the Egyptian religion is absolutely agricultural based. You know, it has, you know, you have, you know, the mother representing the earth, like Isis. The vegetation, you know, would be Osiris. Horus, the child of Isis, might be the sun. You know, and the sun, you know, brings about the resurrection, or somehow Isis brings about the resurrection, Osiris brings about the resurrection of the vegetation. And you know, it all has to do with the sun, the earth, and the vegetation and the cycles of nature. It's all symbolic of that. And the sun, the trip of the sun to the netherworld means wintertime. Okay, and what happens is the sun, the rays wane, it gets colder, it seems like the sun is dying. Okay, if you think about that, in the rays like of summertime, the rays are hot, they're, you know, they're fierce, they're burning, they vivify all of vegetation, they cause the blossoms, they cause the fruiting, they cause the fruits to mature, they cause the harvest. You know, this is the life-giving sun. But when it starts going down to the horizon, going south, at least for the northern people, the rays get, you know, weaker and weaker and weaker and weaker and weaker until it reaches the winter solstice, where it seems to be, you know, almost dead. And the ancient peoples felt that, well, I can get into a little deeper here, is they felt the sun was potentially dying. It was getting weaker, it was getting older, it was aging. They looked at their own bodies, their own lives, and how you get older in life and you age. They felt, and then you die. They felt that the sun was going through similar aging and getting old, but they were terrified that the sun would die. Okay, they were terrified that the sun would die, and the fact that the sun didn't die, they felt, was due to their religion, that their religion was actually responsible for keeping the sun from dying. Unlike humans and animals, they die. They say, "Wow, you know, we don't want the sun to die. We have to do these, you know, these sacrifices." We had to find some way to keep the sun from dying. Now you think, why would we think that? And this is something most people haven't thought about. If we go to the time of about, what is it, 386 or 385 AD, I believe, but, you know, we're in the ballpark somewhere. We're generalists here. We're not obsessive compulsive about, you know, nailing dates and things like that. But there was the time when the sun, you know, sun fails, so to speak, is called. And what happened was, I think that a volcano erupted, a severe volcanic eruption somewhere, spreading heavy, you know, acidic content in the air, dust in the air. It basically blocked out the sun severely. Crops failed all over the world. It freaked everybody out. It absolutely freaked everybody out. And they felt that the, you know, that maybe the sun was dying. This is it. You can imagine people living on some land, and gradually, you know, the sun starts getting weaker and weaker and weaker, and the atmosphere gets darker and darker and darker. Look, they didn't know about some volcano in the tropics exploded. They didn't have any way to understand what's going on, what's going on, what's going on. They said, well, the sun is dying. The sun is dying. Now, I guarantee you that there have been many volcanic explosions in history, along with meteor impacts, asteroid meteor impacts, which also could cause the same or even worse situations. And the ancient peoples have experienced this. Okay, they experienced this, along with eclipse, which really freaked them out. Because they said suddenly the sun just disappeared, and they didn't understand what was happening, and they think, you know, wow, you know, maybe we did something wrong and it's angry at us. You know, it really scared the heck out of them. So if you had these ancient situations where the sun, you know, you go through this period where the sun gets blacked out, very badly blacked out through heavy, heavy dust in the atmosphere and ash and dust and atmospheric disturbance, you know, famine, people dying, terrible experience for them. And they said, holy cow, what can we do to assure that the sun keeps shining? And so the thing about what we're doing in this world, what we've done, is we want to be able to somehow control nature, and so it's not so frightening for us. So these religions were based on the belief that we can control nature, and belief eventually that we are controlling nature. And if something goes wrong, it's because our religion, we're not doing the right practices. So if the sun were to, for instance, in ancient times, to be clouded over, we'd think, oh, the gods are failing us. We need to make great sacrifices. Give them the gold. Give them this. Make sure that we're able to buy, you know, ransom the sun from this imprisonment. And keep in mind that the ancients, we imprisoned people a lot in ancient times, and the kings would ransom. They'd say, okay, I want this released, or the people could ransom the king. Let's say the king is caught in battle. The people of the king's city could ransom that king from prison. They give a huge amount of gold and whatever they have, you know, precious stuff, and then they would release the king from prison. So ransoming the king from prison was very, very well known in ancient times. They thought that the sun was like being imprisoned somehow. Some evil force was imprisoning the sun, and they said, okay, what do you want? What do you want? What do you want? What ransom? How, name your price. Name your price. Name your price. And they said, you know, and then they'd get, you know, diviners and the oracles and stuff, and said, okay, you know, tell us why God is so angry. Nature is angry at us. And the oracle said, yes, you must sacrifice, you know, 20 bulls and give so many talents of gold and, you know, give all, you know, all the treasure, whatever treasure, this amount, sacrifice, give them to the temple, etc., of sacrifice, where we believe that the divinity would accept our sacrifice, and ransom the sun from its imprisonment, so to speak. Whatever's gone wrong in nature, ransom it, whether it's a drought or whatever. This is the basis of the you know, we call pagan, but it's really agricultural religions. Okay, so to cut it short, I know this is very interesting, but we have a goal in mind here. We got to keep moving. These pagan religions were very sophisticated. These agricultural-based religions were very sophisticated. They had very sophisticated rituals, which included all immersion, which included also the real heart of it was that the initiate would die, undergo a death experience or near-death experience, using their imagination and props and staging and various things. And they would go into the underworld, and then the goddess Isis or Ceres, the representing divinity, would bring them back to life, would resurrect them from the dead. And once they were resurrected from the dead, they were a new being, a divine being now, who had immortality, eternal life. This is what they really wanted. And what they really were talking about eternal life is a situation where nature doesn't go crazy, where it's always what you want it to be. Okay, this is what they're talking about. And you live forever in that situation. This was their goal. So they underwent this death and resurrection experience to be initiated. And this was true in Roman times, in the pagan religions. I mean, you talk about, well, the Seraphis initiation, what the Isis cult was exactly that. There's accounts of that, actually, where you went through the underworld, and then from the underworld you were resurrected from that, and then you're presented as divine, like the emperor, with the emperor's robes, the crown, with the palm, you know, on leaves of a raid, like rays from your head, looking like that, and you are presented as now as a divine being if you're an initiate in that cult. Eleusinian mysteries were also, you know, quite similar to that too. There was a lot of mystery cults that and they were based on death and resurrection, just like the Egyptians had been for thousands of years, and Serapis also. So, not only these mystery religions, but particularly Serapis, this religion was extraordinarily popular in ancient times, around the time of Jesus. It had been there for a couple hundred years before Jesus was born, and lasted for maybe 300 years after Jesus, 300 years or more after Jesus was born, all over the Greco-Roman Empire. And with these rituals of death and resurrection from death, be now a divine being, immersion, baptism by water, washing your sins away, one baptism to wash all sins away, so you can be born again, a new person. This already existed. All of this already existed all over the Greco-Roman world. Now, we have evidence of a historian who went to, not only a historian, I think an emperor, went to Alexandria, and he was astonished. He says, the bishops that come here, the Christian bishops come here, they come here to worship Serapis. And he says the Christians are worshiping Serapis, and the people of Serapis also worship Christianity. And they're like interchangeable. They're interchangeable. The evidence of ancient times is that early Christianity and the religion of Serapis were very much similar and very interchangeable. You'd have Christians going to a temple of Seraphim and people called of Serapis going to a Christian church. There's a lot of evidence and testimony about this. And if you look at the two religions, they're very, very similar, actually. Very, very similar. Now, we have, of course, eating the flesh of the god in Christianity, which then you go to the pagan cult of Dionysus, which what they did was the initiates would tear a sacrificial animal apart and eat its flesh and drink its blood. And it was especially important, but this is an ancient pagan practice, actually. And pagans believe that whatever you ate was part of you, and now you were part of them too. You were part of them too. It created this hypostatic union, as it were, of essences. But there was a catch. You had to eat a living animal, living flesh, and living blood. Okay, it could not be dead flesh and dead blood. So what the initiates of Dionysus did was they would, either a bull or a goat or a calf or a fawn or one of these different animals, they would literally seize a live animal and rip it to pieces and then immediately eat the flesh as it was still quivering and shaking and trembling, and drink the blood while it was still hot. This is very important, because if the flesh got cold and the blood got cold, it no longer was effective, because the life, they thought that the life was no longer in it. So what they felt they're doing, they were eating life. They were eating life. This is a pagan custom. And they, of course, they feel God vivifies everything. So that if you eat the flesh and the blood while it's still alive, that you are actually eating God. This is what they believe, that you could actually eat God. And of course, God, they feel, is the vivifying force of nature. But it had to be done, you know, by eating a live animal immediately. But this is a custom that goes way, way back into antiquity. But the cult of Dionysus in Jesus' time was very strong. Very strong, very strong. That temple of Bacchus was part of that. Bacchus, a god of wine. They would also get incredibly drunk and dance in frenzies. And they would go about the countryside. They used to actually, there's a report in ancient times that cult actually would use human sacrifice and tear a human from limb to limb and eat the human. Cannibalism. But then they eventually substituted bulls and goats, cows, fawns, various other animals for it. But the key is they felt that they were eating God. Pretty interesting, huh? So you cannot dodge these similarities. You know, in Christianity, the idea is you're eating the flesh and drinking the blood of Jesus, and by doing that, you're eating God, and you are now in God, and God is in you, the divinity. Okay, the difference is they used a communion wafer instead of actually tearing somebody limb to limb, something limb to limb, some flesh. And of course, they drink the wine too, which is the Dionysus cult would drink wine also, along with the blood. But the wine symbolizes the blood. The wafer symbolizes the flesh. And what they said was, you don't have to tear someone, you don't have to make a live animal sacrifice or human sacrifice, that Jesus' sacrifice could be reenacted by the priests are able to reenact it magically on the altar, and the communion wafer would actually be turned into the living flesh of Jesus, and the wine would turn into the living blood. So you were able to continue on in a very Dionysian cult-like way without the literally tearing the lamb apart and eating it, without literally doing that. So you might say it's a civilizing, a way to move people off of something that is quite, you would say, barbaric and then pagan, into something seemingly more civilized, okay. But the sympathetic magic and the belief in the magic that is still there, still entirely there. I mean, you couldn't divorce the people from that at that time. They were so much into their beliefs. So you might say Christianity was a way of moving pagans off of the more barbaric parts of paganism, to something more civilized, bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. They still kept the sacraments of Serapis, of immersion, immersion and remission of sins through baptism of water, which was Isis. Now, Isis was maybe, you might say, the most popular pagan idol of ancient times, pagan divinity, pagan symbol, pagan religion, the cult of Isis, especially among women. There are lots of accounts from prominent Romans, Greeks and Romans, complaining about their wives and daughters, etc., who are obsessed with Isis, absolutely obsessed. And they say, wow, you know, Isis, what kind of sacrifice can I make to you? I can get my wife back. You know, she's just, you know, all in on that. And so these pagan goddess religions extraordinarily appealed to women. Now, the Christian church was competing with all these pagan cults. There were many. Mithraism was also one of them. The cult of Mithra, Serapis, Isis, Dionysus, Eleusinian Mysteries, and there were some other ones too. Christianity was competing with them, and Christianity did not come into a vacuum. Christianity came in a situation that was absolutely bursting at the seams with pagan religion, and people were extraordinarily religious at that time. It's not like they had a bunch of atheists back then, and Christianity came. No, people were super, super, super hyper-religious, actually. Frantically, wildly devoted and religious at the time. So Christianity came into that sort of situation. It didn't get plopped down in some primitive atheistic vacuum. That is a myth. It never happened that way. And it was competing, competing, competing. Now, how did they manage to get Isis worshippers, who were renowned for being the most devoted worshippers of all, especially the women? How did they get them over? Well, very simply, they just said, hey, we'll take your symbology of Isis and Horus, which is the Madonna and Child. Isis represents the earth, Horus represents the sun, is one way of looking at it, okay? The sun of God. And the sun up in the sky, which is smaller than our earth, it's like a baby, a child, sort of in size-wise to our earth, but it has this radiant power, which somehow resurrects, brings vegetation from the dead. And wintertime, everything died. They think, you know, will it come back in the spring? We don't know. We got to make sure it does. Our religion is what allows it to come back. And so when it comes back in the spring, it's the resurrection from the dead of the vegetation, which everything depends upon. Life and this planet depends upon it. So Horus is the sun and Isis is the mother earth. And this was symbolized by Madonna and child. It was all over ancient Egypt. It was all over pagan Greco-Roman times. It was this ubiquitous symbol of Madonna and child. And Christianity just said, hey, okay, how are we going to convert all these people to Christianity? Let's bring in Madonna and child. Let's say, hey, Isis, all you who love Isis so much, hey, you know, we have Mother Mary and Jesus, mother and child. And this is even more powerful in controlling nature than the Isis cult. We also, hey, Serapis people, we have immersion, baptism, baptism to wash away the sins, initiation of baptism. We have the sacrament of baptism for you. Come on aboard, you know. And the Serapis people also were Isis worshippers. So we got the same stuff, except it's more powerful here. And Dionysus people, come on in. We have the eating the flesh and the blood and partaking of that. No problem. So you might say Christianity is a syncretic religion where it said, hey, to all these other outlying people, you know, it's like an empire building of religion. Say, hey, come on in. We've got a big tent here. Come on in. You'll use the December 25th day, the birthday of Jesus, because that's the day of the death of the sun, the resurrection of the sun, in sun religions, okay, in sun religion, not sun, but sun, S-U-N religions. We'll keep that, okay, the birthday, fine, Easter, fine, spring equinox, when celebrating the true rebirth of vegetation, we'll keep that of the death and rebirth of Jesus, okay? All right, so the birthday of the sun, where the sun is born again, so to speak, and starts coming back from the winter equinox. We'll keep that. We'll keep Easter. On and on and on. They said, come on in. We got a big tent. We're building an empire here. Paul's vision, keep in mind that Paul's vision was a worldwide religion. He wanted Christianity. He was very zealous, Paul. He wanted to, whatever he did, he wanted to monopolize. He was interested in spreading Judaism as the world religion. Now he said, hey, wait a minute. Maybe there's a better religion to spread, Christianity. And so he became this, you know, incredibly zealous missionary, said, going to all these pagan places with very strongly established pagan religions and saying, hey, I got a better religion. We got this God man, we got, you know, and et cetera, et cetera. We got all, but it's similar. Come on in. Empire builder. Now, flash forward to right now, where we have A Course in Miracles, which many do believe is from Jesus Christ. And he is he's very adamant about expressing his disapproval of religions. And he says, many very, very bitter idols have been made in my name. Bitter idol religions, he says. And he's not pleased at all by it. So, and if you listen to his teaching now, you know, you say, what does this have to do with Christianity? I mean, there's some similarities, but historic Christianity, this is not, you know, they're not really that simpatico. And of course, a lot of Christians reject A Course in Miracles and say, this is some work of the devil, you know, I mean, right. That's what because it doesn't agree with historic Christianity. But when you take a real close look at historic Christianity, you say, hey, wait a minute, you know, there's a lot of factors involved here. Not so fast here. I've always felt, you know, that some of the words of Jesus, I feel, yeah, they were from Jesus. Some of the stuff I feel was written by philosophers and spin doctors of the time to make it seem more attractive to the Greco-Roman religious mind. To make it appealing to the Greco-Roman religious mind. These people were not a tabula rasa, blank slate of, we have no religion. We really want a religion. We don't have one. Nothing can be farther from the truth. They were zealots, religious zealots. Very, very, very concerned about controlling nature. Okay, very concerned about it. And God knows the plagues that they had gone through historically, right? The plagues of the smallpox and, you know, bubonic plagues. I mean, the plague of Justin, you know, I mean, the Justinian plague was bubonic plague. Before that, there was the Antoine plague, it was Augustine plague, the plague of Augustine, which they think was smallpox, possibly. You know, drastic stuff. I mean, the stuff that the ancients went through, and we've continued to go through to this day. Droughts, famines, pestilence, plagues, failure of crops, nature just hammered them. And of course, when times went and they had religions and got to control nature, when times were going good, they said, okay, we got it figured out. Now it's working. And then when a plague would hit, they say, oh my gosh, it's not working. Maybe the plague of Augustinian plague, maybe that actually helped Christianity gain the upper hand. They could say, hey, listen, these pagan cults, they didn't work. Look what happened. But, we have the better religion here, and you can, try this out. So the ancient people were always looking for a great religion. They were looking for eternal life. They were looking to control nature. And so you could do a sales job on them and tell them, hey, this is a better way to do it. And especially when you start winning battles, if you say you put the mark of the cross on your forehead, you win this battle. An oracle might say that. And, they wanted to win battles. They wanted to control nature, etc. And so if a religion could be associated with doing those things, as well as promising eternal life, this is what the cult of Isis did, is promised you eternal life in the afterlife if you worshipped Isis. Then you could... you do a sales job on it. You could sell people on it. Absolutely, you could. Especially if you started getting the women, then the men would follow. The women were very religious back then. As of now, the Catholic Church is really run by women. You got priests in dresses, but the most people who go to Catholic churches are women, mothers, women. The men, they pull them in along occasionally, and they tag along and stuff. But it's very much female oriented. So if you sold the women out, the men would be tagged along, pulled into it. They say, okay, just as long as let's just have some order, peace and order here in the empire. I don't want to keep fighting all these battles. we have this amazing history. So you have this, the church of the Red Basilica here, was a seraphim, EUM, like a Colosseum, seraphim. And the Christians just ultimately just took it over, said, okay, now it's a Christian church. This is an extraordinary building. It was built on this massive, this is just the front, that this huge church was part of this massive complex. I think this is from the side. This is just the church. This is just the front of the complex. The complex was like over 250 meters long by 100 meters wide. And it was just, huge scale. And interestingly enough, this whole complex was built on a massive bridge. Massive bridge. It was 600 feet wide, I think, the bridge. Over a couple of rivers, they channeled the river underneath this massive bridge, and this massive bridge, the seraphim of Serapis, was built on this bridge over the river. And they feel that they did that so that they could actually simulate, and they had subterranean chambers too underneath this, a lot of different underground stuff down to the river, and etc. They simulated the flooding of the Nile by using this river. They simulated it. The flooding of the Nile was all important in Egyptian religion because of they'd see the Nile go lower and lower every year. It'll start to get close to running dry. And say, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? It will, And they didn't see what caused the Nile to rise, okay? Because they're in the desert. The rains of the Nile took place. What is this? It took place up Upper Nile, way in the mountains, of Africa, of the Upper Nile. So they never really saw, why does the Nile rise? Why does the Nile rise? Well, they think that the gods make it rise. Our religion makes it rise. They didn't realize it was all the massive rains in the mountainous area of the Upper Nile. Okay? It's just they realize in Memphis and Thebes and in the Delta of Nile that come springtime, come a certain time, the river would start rising and miraculously rising, like resurrected from the dead, and it would baptize the land once again. It would wash away, you know, it would wash away as it rose. You could then use the water to flood the land again. Okay, flood the land again. And like a baptism of the land. And out of this baptism with water of the land would rise a new life, a new crop of vegetation. And they feel that the gods were, you know, doing, rising the Nile for them, so to speak. If you live in a desert and you don't see any rain, that's, you know, interesting way of looking at it. Okay, yeah, this is Pergamum. By the way, where was Pergamon? Pergamon, man. It was up in Turkey. Now we see this shaded purple area, kind of. This was the kingdom of Pergamon. And it kind of extended over, you see, it extends over here towards all the way to the coast. And Pergamon's a little bit here. It's a little bit inland. Sort of the upper, sort of the northwest area of Turkey. And it was a fairly large kingdom. It actually had some independence from the Seleucid Empire, which is the empire that Alexander the Great conquered. Okay, very good. So we're doing a little history lesson here. And you know, what we come up with is the realization that Christianity was not some completely new invention, utterly different from what came before. Not at all. And again, we have the testimony that in the early days of Christianity, that there's an easy acceptance of Serapis, and even a lot of the depictions of Jesus with the long curly hair and the beard were very, very, very similar to Serapis. There's a lot of extreme lot of similarities. And it was a developing religion. It was a religion who was saying, hey, you know, we need to win converts. Because they started out with no converts hardly at all, right? 12 apostles, as they say. And it tried to win converts. What was Paul trying to do? What were the apostles trying to do? Trying to win converts. Now, certainly there was a Paul. I mean, there's a lot of evidence that there was a Saul of Tarsus, a Paul. And certainly there was a lot of missionary work from Christianity. Somebody was doing the missionary work. I mean, you can't just whitewash that out of history, can you? There was a ton of missionary work. And what were they trying to do? They're trying to win converts. And who are they talking to? They're talking to pagans. And they were talking to religious pagans. Well, virtually, you know, all pagans are religious, really. They were talking to ones who had a strong affinity for, you know, they wanted eternal life, they wanted their sins to be forgiven them, they wanted to partake of divinity, you know, etc., etc., etc. They were talking to these people, and they had to convert them. They were trying to convert them. So, is it any surprise that Christianity, as we see it historically, seems to have a lot of marketing appeal to what those pagans back in those time believed? Not seems, it does. And now you have, today, you have someone who says that they're Jesus giving out A Course in Miracles, which is an extraordinary testimony, both in terms of just the seem endless creativity and clarity of the writer, all pointing to eternal life. Just an extraordinary testimony to spiritual brilliance that cannot even be measured. You can just realize, wow, this is just like a fountainhead of spiritual clarity and brilliance, the likes of which we are not accustomed to. You know, to whatever you label it, it's a fountainhead, you know? And this fountainhead is saying, yes, this is what you would call Jesus Christ, and these previous religions, etc., were, you know, bitter idols. You know, this is not my teaching, really. It got badly, badly distorted. Well, now we look back and say, well, is that some sort of surprise? Are we supposed to be surprised at this? And now we can also say, well, duh. And we can understand, you know, why. It's not a matter of some horrible Machiavellian devil distorting us. Not at all. It just had to do with the ebb and the flow of history and as it was then, and the situations and the overall complete gestalt zeitgeist of the time. I mean, just how it went, you know, the need, the emperor saying, we must have peace in our kingdom. Stop your squabbles. I want a creed. Give me a creed, and you're all going to live by that creed. I'm going to see to it, you know. And so they got this compromise. Doesn't satisfy a lot of people. A lot of people reject it, etc. Some say, well, for the sake of peace, let's just go ahead with this. You get the Chalcedonian Creed. You get the Nicene Creed, Chalcedonian Creed. You know, and say, okay, this is the official creed. We're going to use this. You know, Roman Empire was very legalistic, right? You had the code of Justinian code. Later in Byzantine times, you got other codes that were quite extraordinary. Legal. They had massive legal volumes. They're very, very good at administration and legal codes. And they wanted Christianity out to be like a legal code or legal, you know, religious code. Let's get a code here. We don't want this. You know, we don't want these mystics, you know, talking about this and that. Let's get a code that we can enforce. And so eventually it became like that. Now, what Jesus has to say is that the teachings about eternal life, that they really, the intent was good. But the follow through, you know, wasn't so good. It didn't play out clearly as it has to. And so he's basically saying, hey, we have to try a little better than that. Let's not be so lazy. Let's not just say, oh, what we have now, that's it. You know, I'm stuck with that. He said, no, you're not stuck with it. This has its roots in very ancient practices and teachings of wanting to have eternal life, wanting, you know, to have a stability. And these are all fine, great goals, you know, yes, but how it actually played out, you know, is not ideal by any means. It's not ideal. We do not have an ideal religion in this world, really. But to use Christianity as an example, let's just keep it close to home here, it's not ideal at all. A lot of sympathetic magic is being used, a lot of, you know, it's nature worship is being used. It's a amalgamation sort of a lot of different stuff actually in there. Now, the Protestants tried to clean it up a bit, but they kept the sympathetic magic in there, to say the least. The belief in sacrifice, and they went back more to Jewish religion. Actually, Protestants are more closely aligned with Judaism than Roman Catholicism. Roman Catholicism is more aligned with pagan religions, especially Egyptian religions. And Protestantism is more closely aligned with Judaism, which is why they're, you know, extreme supporters of Israel, Protestants. They go back to the law, you know, vicarious atonement through sacrifice. You know, spilling the blood that sets the cosmos right. But that's also, keep in mind, the Jews spent a lot of time in Egypt. You keep in mind that Jacob was sent down to Egypt and became, you know, the Pharaoh's right-hand man. You know, Jacob, the son of Jacob, Joseph was one of the sons. He was, I think, wasn't he like the first, one of his last son, or the first son of Leah or Rachel. What was it, late Rachel? The favorite of Jacob. And the other sons conspired against him because he thought he was so great, and they eventually got sent down to Egypt in slavery, and they became the right-hand man of the Pharaoh. And then eventually, because of drought, famine and stuff, the family of Jacob went down to Israel and stayed there and got land. And ultimately, the story goes that then Moses came along and freed them because they were being enslaved, etc. But the Jews spent a lot of time in Egypt, okay? So you don't think that they weren't aware of Egyptian religion, etc. Of course they were. As I said, the term Maria comes from Egypt. So the sacrifice of, well, Egyptian religion was originally started as Maat, I think it was M-A-A-T, the goddess Maat, which represented cosmic harmony. And the belief was that when problems on Earth happened, the cosmic harmony had been disturbed. What they call the cosmic harmony of Maat had been disturbed. So they worshipped this goddess Maat. by sacrifices and various sacrifices of to keep the harmony. He said, well, so we've done something wrong, which has disturbed the harmony, and we're paying for our sins. Now, the Jews, of course, the Old Testament came from, you know, Moses. It's very much that is saying, these are the laws. You need to keep these laws. If you keep these laws, everything will be great in nature. Everything will run smoothly for you. If you don't, you're going to have problems. Nature's going to bite you. What they called God. They felt that nature is God. It's the workings of, you know, God immanent in nature is the workings of God through nature. Nature represents the workings of God. So, you know, this is very similar to Egyptian, ancient Egyptian religion. Now, John the Baptist, we go back to John the Baptist. John the Baptist is baptizing people, get rid of their sins. Okay, why is this so important at the time? John the Baptist is important because John the Baptist, when he really started getting into that very heavily, he felt there was a lot of sin in Judea, and he felt the wrath of God was going to come upon Judea, and he felt the only way to get free of this was baptism, wash the sins away, and then God would accept this baptism as people repenting, you see, and would not bring destruction upon Judea. The same thing with the ancient prophets, Jewish prophets. They said, hey, you're sinning, people. You're sinning. You're going to bring the wrath of God upon this land. You got to repent. You've got to repent. An example, Nineveh, Assyrian capital. I think Jonah went to Nineveh and said, hey, everybody, you're sinning really badly. Change your ways. And they did change their ways. And then he said, God spared you the wrath. Otherwise, you would have been wiped out. This is the religion's belief of the time. There's this cosmic harmony that you could sin against it, and then it would come chaotic and dangerous and destructive. The destructiveness, the wrath of God, they call it, the wrath of God. So John the Baptist, in particular, was upset with the illegal marriage of Herod and Antipas, who ruled the Galilean area, and the wife of Herod, Philip, who ruled the Decapolis area, I believe, you know, east of the Jordan River, and so apparently the wife of Herod, Philip, which is one of the sons of Herod the Great. He split his kingdom up into like four parts, I think, the rulers of his sons. The wife left Philip and came to Herod Antipas, and John the Baptist said, hey, this is like horrible, this is terrible, you can't do this, it's going to cause, the wrath of God is going to be poured out upon this land of Jerusalem, you know, Judea, because of what you're doing. This is an illegal marriage. This is a very bad marriage. You cannot do, and it's going to cause our destruction. So he was furious at this, and he called out Herod Antipas and said, you know, you got to send your wife back to Philip. You can't do this. And of course, the wife was furious at this because she thought she had made a better move. She said, wait a minute, this Herod Antipas, I'm gonna shift alliances here because I see this is better for me. So she was very angry at John the Baptist. Herod Antipas said, hey, everybody loves this guy. He's baptized, you know, leave him alone. You know, the kingdom is stable right now. People think that they're getting their sins, you know, washed away, and they love the guy. I'm not going to mess with it. But it's the wife. It's the wife that was so upset because she felt that Herod Antipas might decide, hey, John is, I don't want to rock the boat here. I better divorce her and send her back to Philip. So, as the famous story goes, the daughter of, I think Herodias is the wife's name, maybe it's something else, but her daughter, they call her Salome, Salome. She had the daughter dance for Herod when he was drunk, got him real drunk, had the daughter dance some beautiful, sexy dance, and Herod was just thrilled by it, just thrilled. And he said, wow, this is like the best dance ever. I'm just so infatuated, besotted with you, and it's incredible. He said, I'll give you anything you want. I'll give you a third of my kingdom, whatever you want. You want a third of my kingdom, it's yours. He was drunk, he was drugged, he was in, you know, seduced, he was in an extraordinarily expansive, crazy expansive state, you might call it, of just, you know, wow. I'm gonna be the great, generous, you know, emperor, king, or whatever, right? Give her a third of my kingdom. Well, he said, I'll give you whatever you want. So the daughter, it is said, the story goes, said, huh, let me go ask my mom. Well, I don't know, what should I ask for, mom? So she went and asked Herodias, said, what do you want? What should I ask for? And she says, hey, I'll tell you something that I want. And she says, oh, daughter says, okay, what is it? She says, I want the head of John the Baptist. I want the head of John the Baptist on a platter. And so that's what she asked for. Now Herod, Antipas, was like shocked out of his mind. He said, this is horrible. I can't kill John the Baptist. It's going to cause a revolt in the land. This is going to completely destabilize my wonderful, nice political kingdom I have here. That's the worst possible thing you can ever act for. But because he had given his word and everybody had heard him say that, he says, I don't dare go back on my word. I'll lose divine favor if I do that, and this will cause destruction of my kingdom too. So he was caught between a rock and a hard place. And he basically, what he said was, okay, he arrested John the Baptist, chopped off his head. So that shut up the talk about this illegal marriage, you see, which was what Herodias wanted. Of course, the people were furious about it. It did cause destabilization. Which brings us back to Trump, actually. Because there's some concern going on about people saying, you know, that Trump is going to get his head cut off at some point. The establishment is absolutely furious. What is the establishment? The corporate media, what is it? It's really the feminist, radical feminist corporate media is what's running things. That is the establishment right now. The ideology that is running things in the world is feminism, radical feminism, actually. They sent an assassin out in the first debate to really assassinate Trump, and it didn't work. It didn't work. In fact, he pushed back, and they were freaked out about it. Absolutely freaked out about it. And they want his head on a platter. The radical feminists wanted Donald Trump's head on a platter. And they're really calling the shots. They're calling the shots right now in this present administration. They absolutely are. They're calling the shots for big corporations too. Because they made a marriage of convenience, because they realized that women could be marketed to much better than men. Women control most disposable income. They make most decisions in buying things. And they're very much into healthcare, both their own and their families, and they run, and their children, their offspring, and they run the healthcare. And the man's job is basically go out and make as much money as you can. And that's about it in terms of corporations. So this whole corporate healthcare complex is adopted the religion of the goddess, the religion of radical feminism, actually. That is the power structure of the world right now. Donald Trump is saying, hey, this ain't right. This ain't right. We're not going to do it that way. Let's go back to the way things used to be, you know. Really, he's a man that stands up and speaks a man's mind, which men used to do. And says, look, you know, you're making things worse. This is making things worse, the way you're running things. It's much worse. You talk about affordable health care, it's much worse. You know, this flooding, you know, people into this country, it's much worse. And, of course, he's right. I mean, things are way worse than they used to be, actually. And men have no say. They have no say. You ask any young man, they say, we got no voice in anything. I mean, women are completely running things. Going back to the cult of ISIS is basically what they're doing. But anyway, they want Donald Trump's head on a platter. This is my concern. This is a concern of a lot of people. Because Trump is really saying, hey, this situation that we have in the world, you know, it's terrible and it's going to get worse. And we can do a lot better than that. Which is true. He says, let's put this, you know, let's get men involved with good management here. Women are, radical feminists are managing the situation in this world, managing this present administration. They're the ones managing the whole thing, actually. You just look at who's being picked for these key positions, one after the other, after the other, after the other radical feminists. This is just this blatant. Okay. They're the ones who are in charge of the management, and they are absolutely doing a terrible job. And everybody knows it. But you don't say that, you know, you don't dare. It's against, you know, the divine order, my God, you know, it's what's keeping the order of the cosmos in place. As we finally got, you know, the goddess back, goddess Mat, you know, the goddess Isis, you got the women running things. Their management team is going to, you know, make sure that, you know, we don't have a nuclear explosion, is how it really started in the 60s and 70s. As we said, we need to get back to the goddess cult, because the men were, you know, we felt that men had mismanaged to the point where we had these nuclear weapons now, and we are in danger of completely destroying the harmony of the cosmos, which of course the extraterrestrials came here because of the nuclear tests we were doing, and said, hey, you're messing up our dimension too, you know, you're messing up our dimension, we got to stop you. So the idea was that male management was bad and female management was better. This is the underlying belief system of the modern age, is that female management is superior to male management. Now what Trump is doing, of course, is saying, hey, you know, male management can be better than female management. Of course, Trump uses a lot of female managers, actually. As he said, they're killers. I mean, they can be, you know, very tough too. But there's a lot of male management going on in his business empire too. Okay. He's a more traditional male management style. So all of this brouhaha is over management style, actually. But it goes deeper than that. It goes into religious overtones of, for one, how can we stop and make sure nuclear war doesn't happen? And essentially this, they don't call it a treaty, this accord, they call it a treaty, it'd have to be ratified, they call it an accord with Iran, is try to stop nuclear war. That's what they say, at least. Don't get Iran mad. And that was heavily brokered by feminism too, radical feminists. This isn't being played up, but it was. They feel that this is very, and then Trump's going to have a protest about this in Washington. I think Ted Cruz and Trump are going to have this protest in Washington coming up soon about this. It was a very important situation, actually. It's really over management style and who can secure the peace of nature better, is it men or women? And basically, all of this environmental damage that we see in the world has been blamed on men's management style. And the idea is the New World Order will be based on female management style, and they'll bring us in this great era of peace and prosperity, and everything will be great, you know. But the religious overtones are that the world is God, it's divine, it's the great mother, you know, that the universe is this harmonious situation, that we mess it up, that somehow somebody's messing it up, and we need to stay in harmony with it. And the idea is that the male management has messed it up, okay, has messed it up. Female management will restore the order to it. This is the underlying religion of the times, folks. Okay, so you need to be aware of what's going on. And there's this huge conflict now because the male management style is saying, hey, you know, we need a voice too. You're shutting us out. You're shutting us out, which is true, being shut out. That style, you still have men in management, corporate management, but it's all, they're puppets for radical feminism. It's the female style of management is the PC culture, folks. And this is all being driven by pharmaceutical healthcare industry, who wants you to remain believing that you are mortal mind, actually. The goddess says, yes, you are mortal mind, but I can give you immortality. But you're still immortal. You're not on the level of the gods, so to speak. Now, Jesus has a completely different message than the pagans, okay? Completely different message. Jesus' message is that you have always been eternal life, that immortal life has never happened. Okay, this is the message of Jesus. Mortal life never happened. Never happened, never happened, never happened. It's all wishful thinking. It's all pretend. It's all pretense. What we truly are is eternal life, and we've always been eternal life. The world, what we call the world universe, has always been eternal life. There is no universe. There is no world of mortal existence. There is no mortal mind. It's a pretense. For example, if you were to pretend, like do an impression of yourself or pretend you're something other than what you are, you would also pretend that this character you've invented that you're pretending to be has their own mind, right? You wouldn't say, yeah, well, it's my mind pretending to be this other character. No, you'd get in character like actresses do, and they'd say this character has its own mind. So this is what we've done. We, eternal life, are pretending to be mortal life. And in order to do that, we claim there's mortal mind, and it's mortal mind that is vivifying and orchestrating mortal existence, right? This is not true. We're imagining it. We're pretending. There's no mortal mind. It's all eternal mind that is doing all of this. This is the teachings of Jesus, plain and simple. Very cut and dry different than pagan teachings. The universe is not the expression of God, so to speak. It's our own pretense. It's our own pretense. This world of impermanence is our own imagination, pretending that we're not eternal life. This is what it is. It's not that we're mortal life and we can become immortal, or the Egyptians thought that they would be reborn again. There are various beliefs. One of them was that the spirit of death departed the body and went somewhere else, and that later on it would come back and revivify the body. That's why they mummified the bodies. And of course, the kings and the wealthy people, the only ones that could have all the rites of mummification, they kept these bodies. They were so good at it. The mummies still exist, you know, in amazing ways. They still can get DNA out of it. But they wanted to keep the body intact so the spirit would come back later and re-enter the body, and it would come back to life. He resurrected. But it was mortal life, really, that they were resurrecting, wasn't it? And then eventually the cult of Serapis was that anybody can have this happen as long as they confessed belief in the deity and had their sins washed away in baptism, that anybody could have this immortal existence. The spirit, after their death, would also come back to their body. That's why they bury bodies. Like Christians, Catholic Christians, bury bodies and believe in a resurrection of the dead at the end times, meaning the spirit would come back and revivify the body. That's why they bury them in the ground, and they expect that if you die, you know, confessed, believe in the deity, the Christian deity, that the spirit will come back, resurrect the body from the dead. St. Paul absolutely believed that. The early Christians absolutely believed in that. Same thing as the Egyptians. It's the same belief. There's no real difference at all. That's what the Egyptians believed. And then Serapis says that even the commoners can do it. So they extended, it became, you know, populist religion. It wasn't just the pharaohs that could have this happen, that everybody could have it. So this was a huge change to how it used to be. They said, hey, religion is not just for the rich people who can buy eternal life, immortality. You can have it too now. You just have to go through this initiation, baptism, believe in the deity, you know, that has the power to resurrect you from the dead, and you will be also, at some point at the end times, your spirit will come back and resurrect your body from the dead. So this is what they believe. Amazing, huh? Amazing, amazing, amazing. Well, but Jesus' teaching is completely different. Completely different. You are eternal life. You've always been eternal life. You've never departed from eternal life. You've never cast it away from you in the slightest bit. It's all pretense. You've been pretending that there's some other creation, some other not spirit, some mortal life, and believing this mortal life has mortal mind. Okay, this is not true. And the efforts to work with mortal mind to gain eternal life is completely invalid. It doesn't work. So that's not the way. But this is the way that many have tried. They think, well, I have to work with mortal mind and make mortal mind become eternal mind. This is becoming is not true. It is not true. And this is why we have so much trouble and have floundered. Okay. But if you listen to the teachings of Jesus, the real teachings, you do the practice of Jesus and others who also have awakened to this truth suggest, then you will come to realize, hey, this has all been just my own pretense. It's like a dream. I don't have to become immortal, or eternal. I have always been eternal. This world, this is just nothing but pure spaciousness. This doesn't affect me at all. It's all been a dream. It's all been a dream of appearances, just mere appearances, misperceiving them, believing that they had something had to do with mortal mind. There is no mortal mind. Never has been. So you certainly don't need to treat mortal mind. You don't need to try and change it. You need to treat it. You need to, you know. That's false religion. That's false teaching. What we do is we wake up to the fact that we are eternal life, and to practice this pretend abstraction, what it does was it allows us to continue to pretend that there is this maybe mortal mind, and yet mortal mind is practicing in such a way that eternal life says, which is spirit, which is what we are, says, hey, wait a minute, this sounds awfully like what I would practice if I had pretended to be mortal mind but really wasn't mortal mind, and I was trying to remind myself that I really am not mortal mind, that I'm truly eternal life. This seems exactly like what I would recommend to myself. Isn't that odd? Isn't this interesting? So spirit likes this. Hey, wait a minute, this is very interesting. Why am I practicing this way? This is why it's so important. This practice is so important. Why am I practicing this way? This is very interesting, because this is how I, again, this is just exactly what I would recommend to myself if I had pretended to be something other than what I am, and pretended that there's another mind causing this, is causative of this different being entity. But in fact, it was me pretending all this the whole while, and there isn't mortal mind at all. It doesn't, never existed. This is exactly what I do. I'd have mortal mind mouth these words, to remind myself that it really is just mouthing these words, me doing all of this, mouthing these words. See, I wouldn't try to drop pretense altogether immediately. I wouldn't attack it. But I would gently, lovingly, and wisely have it practiced this way. I'd wake myself up this way. This is how I'd wake myself up from the dream. So this is why this practice of imitating abstraction by, yes, I am absolutely here and absolutely not here. I am absolutely still and absolutely not still. I am absolutely at peace and absolutely not at peace. I am absolutely one and absolutely not one. You know, this is the most basic way of practicing it, which is to get into it. This is how you get into it. Then there's variations spun off that, but it's just like learning to play piano. You learn to play the basic chords first, and then you can play any song with those chords, and then you can spin off variations. But you say, hey, I am both eternal life and not eternal life. I am both absolutely eternal life and absolutely not eternal life. This is pure abstraction, right? Neither do you have a concept of eternal life, nor do you have a concept of not eternal life. You're neither one, neither a concept of nor not. See, I am both absolutely eternal life and absolutely not eternal life. Those concepts cancel each other out. And you can say, I both don't have a concept of eternal or non-eternal life, nor do I have a non-concept of eternal and not eternal life, which is a state even more abstract. You know, you can go even more abstract. And you can then say, well, I'm neither eternal life, nor am I not eternal life. Neither am I both, nor am I, but I'm both and neither. I'm both and neither. I'm both and neither. I'm both eternal life and not eternal life, and I'm neither eternal life nor not eternal life. You know, like that. And but then you can go even deeper and deeper and deeper back. But that is when you feel expert at it, and you'll get expert at it very quickly, actually. Very quickly. Doesn't take long. I think in the last video I misspoke about Longchenpa in coming November 2nd to 2014. It was actually 2013, because I look back when I ordered the book Spaciousness, the Radical Selection of the Vajrahara. It was 2013, November 2nd, 2013. So it's been a year and 10 months. A lot of practicing since then. I've done a lot of practicing. He's the great bodhisattva practice, in my opinion, meaning inspires us to practice. The idea of these great bodhisattvas is they're supposed to be inspirational, help us. They have to inspire us. If they don't motivate us, what good are the teachers if they don't motivate us? Motivation is what they do, the great teachers, okay? They wouldn't be great teachers if they didn't have the capacity to motivate us. So I find Longchenpa the bodhisattva of practice, of right effective practice. And of course the bodhisattvas are fresh in the moment, always in the moment. So they can suggest to us teachings for right now. What they see is what is be most effective right now, given the situation of right now. Well, they see it as not a situation either. It is both a situation and isn't a situation, so to speak. But from the totality of what is most helpful, grace can see that, the Holy Spirit sees that, and they can suggest a practice to us right now, fresh right now. And he said, do this. This is what's going to work for you. So they are not beholden to any past whatsoever. These teachers are never beholden to what they said in the past or suggested in the past. It's always fresh right now. And if you take it that way, it's great. He's like, you ask, I need a horse, please help me. They say, here's a horse, ride this horse. Get on the horse and ride it. It's that simple. So I've never been beholden to any past in religion at all. I've always been extremely ecumenical and now oriented of what works now, what's going to work now for us. So if Jesus says, read A Course in Miracles, do this, that's what I did. I say, okay, boss. He's the boss, okay. If Longchenpa says, try this practice, I say, okay, boss, I'll try this practice. You're the boss. You know, the boss of practice, right? Of extraordinarily adept practice. He's the king of the adepts in terms of suggesting practices. So if you want to be an adept, you know, I say, hey, I want to be an adept. Okay. He says, try this. I say, okay, but you're the boss. You're the boss. I'm not going to say, what did you do previously? It doesn't matter. If you suggest this now, you're the boss. This is the horse you're giving me. I'm going to ride the horse. Plain and simple. You have to be very pragmatic on the path. Reason is very pragmatic. It doesn't get hung up. So, you know, intellect gets hung up, reason does not get hung up. So this practice of imitating abstraction is extraordinarily helpful for us to wake up and realize that this has all been a pretense. Nature, mortal mind, bodies, it was all a dream, a pretense. There is no separate mortal mind. It's just the excuse that we've been using to say, well, it's not me that's pretending to be someone else. It really is someone else, and they have their own mind, you know. How else can we pretend, really convince ourselves that we're dead to what we are unless we think that death has some mind that's causing it? See, we're not causing it. We're not pretending. This is actually causative. It really exists. This death, mortality really exists. Of course we have to pretend that this mortal mind is separate from us. There's actually a mind doing this. But there isn't. It's spirit that's doing all of it. There's no such thing as mortal mind. There has never been mortal mind at all. This is the essence of Jesus' teachings. There's never been mortal mind at all. Mortal mind has never done one thing, therefore it's never existed. It's never had any effect at all. We're just dreaming the effects and then claiming that there's this causative agent we call mortal mind, making it up, pretending. It's pure pretense, pretending, which is ultimately based on our arrogance of wanting to be greater than God. We want to be the prime creator. So this is all very cut and dried, all very black and white, all very simple. I'm going to end this video now because some issues are going to arise here, and I need to do that. So, very great. I hope you've enjoyed this, and this has given you a little boost. This is what it's all about. And keep on. Be a generalist. Get the feel of it. Stay focused on eternal life. It's true. There's only eternal life. Mortal mind is not just spirit pretending to be dead. The spirit, and there's no such death. There's no, it's all pretense, plain and simple.